This will be our ninth exposition of the book of Luke. We're in the second chapter, and we'll be covering verse 40 through the end of the chapter, which is verse 52. And the child grew and waxed strong in spirit, filled with wisdom. We're talking about a child here. Filled with wisdom, and the grace of God was upon him. Now, his parents went to Jerusalem every year at the feast of the Passover. And when he was 12 years old, they went up to Jerusalem after the custom of the feast. And when they had fulfilled the days as they returned, the child Jesus tarried behind in Jerusalem, and Joseph and his mother knew not of it. But they, supposing him to have been in the company, went a day's journey, and they sought him among their kinsfolk and acquaintance. And when they found him not, they turned back again to Jerusalem, seeking him. And it came to pass that after 3 days they found him in the temple, sitting in the midst of the doctors, both hearing them and asking them questions. And all that heard him were astonished at his understanding and answers. And when they saw him, they were amazed. And his mother said to him, "Son, why hast thou thus dealt with us? Behold, thy father and I have sought thee sorrowing." And he said unto them, "How is it that ye sought me? Wist ye not that I must be about my father's business?" And they understood not the saying which he spake unto them. And he went down with them and came to Nazareth and was subject unto them, but his mother kept all these sayings in her heart. And Jesus increased in wisdom and stature and in favor with God and man. Now, Jesus is really the only person you can write a very brief biography about. Or you could write a very exceeding large one, too. There was such substance in him.
Yeah.
See, the gospel narrative now leaps from when he was 2 years old to when he was 12. And there's not one single thing. Not one single sentence or word is said about him in that, in those 10 years. When Jesus was 2 years of age, you remember, the wise men found him, and then they were warned that Herod was seeking his life, and so they returned him another way. And Joseph, the angel appeared to Joseph and told him to get down to Egypt, flee down there. For Herod will seek the young child to destroy him. Then after some time, maybe they returned to Nazareth. But that was when he was two. From 2 to 10, nothing. We know he was two at the time because the scriptures tell us that Herod issued an edict. He said to slay all the children that were in Bethlehem and in all the coasts thereof from 2 years old and under, according to the time which he had diligently inquired of the wise men. So Jesus was 2 years old, and they weren't in a manger.
Yeah, that's right. Amen.
When the wise men came, they were living in a house, because they found him in a house. But that's another example of Catholic art.
Yeah.
Almost 100% of Catholic art is biblically wrong. I've spent some time on this, so I was kind of astounded. Either got some kind of a halo or little cherubs floating in the air. Something's wrong about that art. And this is one where there you are in the manger, and the shepherds are there, and the wise men are there, you know, and there they all are, nice in the manger. Now Herod, not a lot said about him, because Herod was not a significant factor in the birth and growth of Jesus. He was like a blip on the screen. That's all he was. He was just he was an incidental person. Yes.
That, this was the work of Satan, obviously.
Yeah.
Because people are not, have never really been good readers. And so they'll look at a picture and they'll believe a picture.
Yeah.
They'll believe it. And so the truth has been altered with these pictures.
Well, yes.
For the time. Now, in our day, we have Hollywood.
Yeah.
And they've come up with a different way.
Their pictures.
Yeah, they're pictures, but they're even more subjecting to our minds because I know you've ran into people and they say, well, we know that Pharaoh lived because in the movie he lived.
Yeah.
Well, but in the Bible it says he didn't. But people are not big on reading.
Yeah. I know what you mean. An incident. Herod, like Pharaoh, were incidents.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
They weren't key people at all. Now, I've noticed over the years that I've become acutely aware how much time is wasted on incidents or incidental people.
Yeah.
It's amazing how much time men will spend on incidental things.
Mm-hmm.
But see, God didn't.
Amen.
That's the point at this to see. At the time of our text, Joseph and Mary went to the Passover feast, as was their custom, taking Jesus with them. And when they returned, our text is going to tell us Jesus stayed in Jerusalem, but he didn't tell Joseph and Mary that he was. And there's a lot of interesting things we're going to see in this text. Now, keep in mind that Jesus never sinned.
That's right.
He didn't sin as a 2-year-old.
Yeah, that's right.
And I don't know of any other 2-year-old that could be said about, but he couldn't, he didn't sin. He never sins. You got to see that.
Amen. Yeah.
He didn't sin as a 2-year-old or a 10-year-old or a 12-year-old or a teenager,
mm-hmm,
or a young man or a full-grown man. He never sinned. And it's important to note that, but here's something else that's very important to note about that. Jesus used what he used to overcome sin is the same resources you've got.
Yeah, amen. Mm-hmm.
He didn't overcome as deity. He overcome as a man, see? So he had to employ the same kind of resources we employ.
Mm-hmm.
But the difference was that he used them profitably. Now in Christ Jesus, we've received a lot of resources. It's not acceptable to live at a lower level with a lot of resources. This is not acceptable. If there's somebody, anybody, before Christ that is more godly than you, you got to like repent and do something about this. It's that serious. We're talking about men like Moses, like David. So they didn't have what you've got.
That's right.
They didn't have what you got. So if they ended up more holy than you are,
mm-hmm,
it's like, I don't know how you could hold hope out to a person like that.
Mm-hmm.
Well, we keep these things in mind as we go through this text. Now the text says, and the child grew.
Mm-hmm.
Well, that's something right there. And the child grew. Now keep in mind where the child that grew is. He's in the world. He's dominated by Satan, principalities and powers. There's religious corruption in the world. There's no corruption in him, but he's in a totally corrupt environment. And that environment is the environment in which he, quote, grew. He obtained wisdom, stature, that's his physical status, and favor with God and man. He did this in the environment we're in. That tells you how powerful Satan isn't. He used the same resources, and his parents would use these same resources in reduced measure that you use. Satan working through Herod tried to get rid of this child. See, that was just one effort that we read about. Mm-hmm. That one was revealed.
Yeah.
But don't think that all through this time Satan didn't engage in some kind of initiative to get rid of this. He heard everything that was told Mary and Joseph. And he knew this was the Son of God. That's why he tempted him. If you are the Son of God, see, he knew who this was. So how can a small child be expected to grow up into manhood with all this corruption around him? Well, Joseph and Mary will take care of him when he's young. But there in the background, there's something else.
Yeah.
Psalm 91:11 says, "For he will keep he will give his angels charge over thee to keep thee in all thy ways." This is true of Christ. The angels superintended the growth of this child. I'm showing how he was able to grow up. It wasn't. This was the Christ child.
Yeah, that's right.
That grew up in this environment. It was very raw. And carnal and fleshly and distorted. Mm-hmm. He grew up under Caesar's nose, so to speak. Child grew. Now those precise words, the child grew, those precise words are said of Isaac. Mm-hmm. Genesis 21:8 says the child grew. Mm-hmm. They're said of Moses, Exodus 2:10, the child grew. They're said of Samson, Judges 13:24, the child grew. And they're said of John the Baptist, Luke 1:180, the child grew. So see, these are all important figures. So if you have little children, they'll grow.
Yeah. Yeah.
Children will grow. All of those children I just mentioned to you had a special work, and therefore they were provided special protection because there were special initiatives launched against them in the world. Now, in spite of the vulnerability of childhood and the limited strength of Joseph and Mary, the child grew. Other versions say he continued to grow, so it was he just didn't just pop up all of a sudden, he's older. Some versions say he became tall. Those are stupid translations. I don't know why people like that engage in translating the scripture. He grew up, grew to maturity. The point is not the various stages of youthful development. Mm-hmm. It's that he advanced to maturity because he was going to have to offer himself as a mature man. He couldn't offer the sacrifice needed for sin when he was a boy. It wouldn't have counted.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
It wouldn't have been sufficient.
Right.
You had to be a fully mature man who had passed through the fire and the water himself and knew from experience how to be sustained in that type of environment. So he partook of flesh and blood, but he advanced to his appointed time.
Yes.
In spite of the fact that he was in the enemy's territory. Now there's a parallel between the way Jesus grew up and spiritual growth.
Yes.
The development of newness of life is parallel to Jesus growing up. Being a babe was not the intention of Jesus coming into the world. He didn't come into the world to be a baby. That's not why he came. He came to lay down his life, but he had to start out with babies. So being born again, the point isn't just be born again. Mm-hmm. That's not the point.
Yeah.
The point is to be ready to stand before Lord blameless.
Yes.
So that starts out with newness of life. But newness of life is not the point. Mm-hmm. It's the means to the point. And I know very few people who teach that. Mm-hmm. And fewer still that know it. Mm-hmm. It's important to see that. And there's an advancement. He says he waxed strong in spirit. That doesn't mean he was stubborn or bullheaded.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. If you got a child that's stubborn or bullheaded, you as a parent, it's your business to get that out of him.
Yeah.
Do it now.
Yes.
Get that out of him. So how can I do it? Well, you be determined to do it, and then it'll come to you. Now he waxed strong in spirit. He became resolute. The older he became, he became more resolute, more firm, not in the sense of being stubborn, but in the sense of carrying things out, you know, this sort of thing. He is maturing in his mind and in his spirit. Like, he didn't grow up playing games. Not against playing games, but almost damn. But that's not that. He's strong in spirit. Because what he was going to do is going to call for a resolute, determined spirit that didn't flag or lag behind. And he was filled with wisdom. Just from two and up. He's filled with wisdom. Increase in wisdom, some versions say. Continued to increase in wisdom. In other words, he advanced in the ability to take knowledge and use it right. That's what wisdom is. You take knowledge, you use it right. There comes a time when a child may memorize mathematical tables and that, but there comes a time when they can handle money. They can use their math and handle. That's growing in wisdom. Yes.
I've often been surprised by the number of preachers I've heard say that Jesus knew everything.
I know.
I've heard that a lot. That, like, when the scriptures, when it says Jesus knew what was in it, they said, well, of course he knew. He knew everything. He was God.
Yeah. Forget, he divested himself of that prerogative, so to speak.
Brother Gibbon, I can also see your point about how you're saying, like, when you wax strong, this doesn't imply stubbornness. This is something that was completely new. Like when it says, like, he learned obedience, it's not like taming us like a wild animal, so to speak. But this is something that was in the beginning
with Jesus.
When he was with God. This wasn't something he ever experienced. He never had to grow. He never had to advance.
He was at the top.
He went from being the highest to being the lowest. Yeah. So in that sense, it was he became strong.
That's right. And as Brother Jason said, this postulates that he didn't know everything. He had to learn.
That's right.
Yes, Brother.
Growing up, he grew up in the lowest state, like Brother Jonathan said, but in him was found no guile, nothing at all. And so it is with us in the spirit. Christ has given us a new body that comes from him. So we, in what God has given us is no guile, and we can continue on and agree with the writer. It says, you've been given something that cannot sin, so feed that.
Yeah, that's right. Mm-hmm. That's right. Yeah, the difference of Jesus didn't have a vulnerable part. We do, but the part that comes from God is like Jesus had here. He overcame with the same resources you overcome with. That's why he's able to be an effective high priest.
Yes.
If he didn't, he couldn't empathize with your situation, see? But he can, because he passed through the same thing, not the same kind of temptation as you, but it was a stronger temptation to level at him. Yes.
Jesus received the resources that were needed from the Father at the time he needed them, that's exactly what Christ does for us too.
Amen. It's exactly right. And he was filled with wisdom. Not like one fell swoop, where he was filled. He advanced and he was filled up with wisdom so that he was able to take what he knew and translate it into life, so to speak. In the expression filled with wisdom, we see him becoming a man. Becoming a man involved learning. And the word submitted to do this. See, that's this is Mother Jones said he didn't do this before he came into the world. He didn't have to learn. But he submitted to this process because this was involved. If we were going to safely navigate from earth to heaven, we would have to have more than a new nature. We had to have somebody in heaven to represent us and funnel, because of this other factor that we live with, the old man of the sinful nature. So in order for him to be effective high priest, this Jesus sanctified the path that we're taking. See, he prepared to go back to heaven the same way we're preparing to go there to be with him forever. He sanctified the way, see, by going over it himself. When he was young, advantageous, he went over the same road. This is the area where we are expected to increase. We're expected to increase in this area of wisdom. I've known people, church people, that at the same level of wisdom that I had known for like 50 years, known them for 50 years, and they haven't went 1 millimeter past what I knew 50 years ago. Exactly the same place. They still hardly know anything. Still can't even find the books of the Bible. I mean, it's that sort of elementary. And I want to go on record how thankful I am to be out of that kind of an environment. I'm very thankful for it. See, Joseph and Mary did not provide that kind of environment for Jesus. That's why God was especially selective in picking out the people to raise Jesus, and in the grace he gave them to do it. See, they raised him. Yes. There weren't he wasn't taught by angels. There weren't angels that came down and taught him. Joseph and Mary, they were devout, see? And they raised up young Jesus. What a stewardship.
Amen.
Could you imagine? And the grace of God was upon him. Other versions say the favor of God was upon him. Living Bible says God poured his blessings out upon him. The spiritual blessing of God was upon him, another version says. In other words, this is not all that easy to explain. The grace of God was upon him. It said of the early church, great grace was upon them all. This text is the first place in the Bible grace is said to be on somebody. This is it. After 4,000 years of human history, this is it. This is the first time grace was said to be on somebody. Prior to Word becoming flesh, very little was said in the Scripture about grace. It's mentioned a couple of times, but not very often. And none of the references say grace is on anybody. Most of the time, it referred to being spared from the punishment of death. So does grace for a while, you know, not punishing us. That's kind of the sense in which it's mentioned in Scripture. Moses, he mentioned grace. In one of his prayers, he said that I may find grace in thy sight. He knew that I'll say it in a kind of a low and vulgar way. If God doesn't like you, he's not going to do much for you. Favor is grace has to do with him being attracted to it. He's not attracted to everybody.
Yes, amen.
He sure wasn't attracted to Cain, was he?
No.
Or Sodom and Gomorrah, was he?
No.
Or the people that lived in Noah's day, was he?
No.
So you just have to know Esau, was he?
No.
You just have Pharaoh, was he? You just have to know your Bible, or God isn't attracted to everybody.
Yes.
He sure isn't. Noah found grace. In the eyes of the Lord. Through Jeremiah, he said, thus saith the Lord, the people which were left of the sword found grace in the wilderness, even Israel, when I went to cause them to rest. So, favor. God favored them by subduing inimical forces and not causing their death. As to the meaning of the word grace, it's just not easy to define either. One Greek lexicon says, goodwill, loving kindness, favor, attends and assists one to be committed or commended to the protecting and helping favor of God. So, but it's all kind of, what does that mean? You know, it's not, you can't define it this way. The best way to define it, you got to experience the grace of God. That's the only way you'll know what it really is. The grace of God not only protects you, it gives you benefits that you need. To be in God's favor means he's holding you up, giving you resources, so forth. Another meaning is favorable attitude. Another one is favor, kindness, goodness, benevolence. See, all that very, very, very general. And I've kind of found that, if that when it comes to like key words, like grace or faith or something like this, it's very difficult to define them lexically. They go beyond human explanation. Now, as Jesus is 12 years old, his parents went to Jerusalem every year at the Feast of the Passover. Every year. You think, well, in 12 years, maybe something would have happened in the family. Every year, every year. His parents. It says his parents. Other verses read his father and mother. You'd be surprised how many versions read that way. Now, it may seem like a technical point. Joseph was not the father of Jesus, as the above version states. The word translated parents, as used by Greek-speaking people, meant begetter or parent, legal or biological. So you could call Joseph a parent. If you want to be strict, but not father. Mary will refer to Joseph as Jesus' father in Luke 2:48, thy father. She called him his father too. But this wasn't right. And Jesus rebuked her for it.
Yeah.
In spite of the circumstance and the case that the Holy Spirit spoke on the matter that he would be the son of God, not the son of Joseph.
Yes.
I name the versions of scripture here that say Joseph his father. Now, it's owing to a variance, an infamous variance in Greek manuscripts. The Syriac version uses the word for father. The others use the word for parent. And I personally prefer that because of what Jesus is going to respond to this. I went up to Jerusalem every year, made this unusual pilgrimage of about 90 to 95, roughly 100 miles. And it was fulfillment of a commandment God had issued. Started way back in Exodus 12. And the Jews were commanded, this is one of the feasts, they had to go up three feasts every year. They had to attend these feasts. You didn't have the option. God never did say, if you're able, he never.
That's right.
You had to keep these feasts. Feast of the Passover. Now, the Jews didn't do well keeping this feast. There's no indication that they kept it during their wanderings in the wilderness. They didn't keep this feast. But when they entered Canaan, Joshua renewed the Passover feast. Once again, then the people quit observing the Passover. Now, remember, God said to observe it. Now, we leap way up here centuries later, and Mary and Joseph, they did. They kept it. Once again, that time lapsed. They didn't keep the Passover until the time of Hezekiah, and he renewed. He started keeping the Passover again. And in spite of this, this was one of the fundamental feasts. This was not like a picnic. This was celebrating their deliverance from Israel. And he repeatedly, all through the prophets, God refers to how when he delivered them from Egypt, and the Passover was an official remembrance of that deliverance, and they didn't keep it. And then after Hezekiah lapsed again, they didn't keep it. And then under Josiah, he renewed it again. There's no record of the Passover being kept during the Babylonian captivity, so Ezra renewed it again after the Babylonian captivity. And Ezekiel, he, inspired by God, he gave some instructions about keeping the Passover. But when Messiah came into the world, it could not be during one of these times when the Passover feast wasn't being kept. He could not do it. When Jesus was here, that Passover feast had to be in place and observed when Jesus came, because he was the Passover.
Yeah, amen. Right.
So he wasn't born during those other times when they stopped keeping it. You gotta see this.
Yeah, uh-huh.
When the time arrived, this feast is renewed.
Yeah.
This was God, see,
right. Amen.
Renewing this feast. In fact, he's going to offer himself during...
Uh-huh.
During that feast. All of this was by divine intention. The Passover feast was instituted. So far as Israel was concerned, as a remembrance of being delivered. As far as the Messiah was concerned, it was a type of the deliverance that Jesus would work. And it had to be in place when Jesus entered the world.
Amen.
So they went up to Jerusalem. And he was 12 years old at the time. And this was their... They went up after the custom of the feast, the text says, when he was 12. So this probably was the 12th one that Jesus had been to from young up. So the young Jesus, he's raised up in a culture of obedience. See?
Yes. Uh-huh.
Where what the Lord commanded took precedence over everything else. When the Passover came, that drowned out everything else. Nothing else was significant during that time. It was a seven-day feast, and everything dropped. And you see how God's working there, that when Jesus came, he brought a cessation to every kind of normalities among his people. It all stopped at that time when a Savior was born. I think it's a good thing to note that this kind of commitment is almost totally absent in our time. There's not a... In church people, as a rule, there's not a compelling urge to do what God said. This drive is largely missing. Not there. In spite of the fact that we've received a lot of resources that could make us equal to this. And I named some of the resources that were given there, none of which Joseph and Mary didn't have any of these. It's all spiritual blessings and heavenly places and all things pertaining to life and godliness. See, those were all given after sin was taken away.
Yeah.
Not before sin was taken away. So just being obedient, outwardly obedient, you could be perfectly obedient outwardly. I mean perfectly. Outwardly you can. Because these people were.
Yeah.
These people outwardly were perfect obediently. They had inward... things that struggles, I understand, but they did keep this feast.
Amen.
And what they were told to do, they did it routinely. With the Sabbath day, things shut down on the Sabbath day, see? That they were faithful in doing this. This is the kind of environment Jesus is raised in. Jesus could never have been raised up in the USA. In our day, if Jesus would have come, there's not even faithful stewards. Christian people aren't even noted for faithfulness in common things, let alone in raising the Son of God. So you see how God worked this. He brought the Messiah in during a period of time when people were conscious of obedience, and there were godly people who would not allow anything to interrupt their obedience to God. They just wouldn't allow it. That's all there was to it. They had this one thing, if I desired of the Lord. And they went, it says, to Jerusalem after the custom of the feast. Now, some of the versions really botched this up. Here's how they translated this. The text says, they went up to Jerusalem after the custom of the feast. Some versions say, as their way was, that this is what they did. According to the custom of the festival, that's good. As they were accustomed, it was their like their habit, which they attended each year. Living Bible says, as they always did. international. Now, what I'm showing is there's a difference between as they always did and as the Lord commanded. There's quite a difference in those two. The custom of the holiday. They went there as usual for the celebration. They made their customary stay, as was their custom, the Amplified Bible. This is not what the text means. It doesn't mean it was their custom. It was the custom that God put into place. In fact, the word translated custom means usage prescribed by law. It's legal terminology. So they went up according to the custom that God had established, not the custom that they had, that they had established. The Passover was among the set feasts. That phrase is found in Numbers 29:39. Set feasts. There were a number of these. The festival lasted 7 days. On the first day, there was to be no work. Then there was a burnt offering to be made of 2 bullocks, 1 ram, 7 lambs of the first year without blemish. This is after the customs. This is the custom. Meal offering was to be made for the bullock, ram, and 7 lambs. 1 goat was to be offered for a sin offering. These offerings were made in addition to the morning offering. These offerings were to be made for 7 days. On the 7th day, they were to do no servile work. See, that's the custom of the Passover. I don't know how precisely this feast was observed by average Jews at the time, but as far as Mary and Joseph was concerned, they went up according to that custom. And one other word that attended about this Passover feast, as well as the others, you shall not appear before the Lord empty. Don't come before me without something to offer me. Okay? So when it says they went up according to after the custom, that's the custom that it's talking about. In other words, you see their devotion, the devotion of Joseph and Mary. It wasn't just a mere habit at all. And when they fulfilled the days, certain things had to happen at certain times, and they did the certain things at the certain times. See, they fulfilled all the days. They made no attempt to rob God of his time. This is time that God reserved for himself. Yes. Now, this is time you give to me, 7 straight days. Here's what you do during those 7 days. Now, it's the opinion of some that God no longer requires specific times. But God has never operated like that. Abraham had to leave Ur at a certain time. Jacob had to return to Canaan at a certain time. Israel was commanded to leave Egypt at a certain time. Israel was required to appear before the Lord at certain times. The Day of Atonement was observed at a certain time. Habakkuk was given a vision for an appointed time at a certain time. Jesus was born at a certain time. Jesus was required to lay down his life at a certain time. He rose from the dead at a certain time. The Day of Pentecost came at a certain time. The Holy Spirit called Barnabas and Saul at a certain time. Jesus will return in glory at a certain time. God has determined his purpose will be fulfilled in the dispensation of the fullness of the times, certain time. The first day of the week is of special significance, certain time. There is such a thing as a certain day that limits the time given to respond to the Lord. So God, he operates certain times. Now this adapts very well to life. Certain times. I know when the Lord's day comes, that's a certain time. For speaking for myself, it's a certain time. Mm-hmm. There's things that, yes, over which things I have power over, I just don't allow them to take precedence. And if I don't, I pray against them. Mm-hmm. See? Mm-hmm. Certain times. This is the way God is. Yes. Why is God this way? This is an excellent way to test your obedience, to test your spirit, to test what kind of person you are. Are you able to change your agenda to meet his? See? Yes. I can see why he does things this way. Now, the commandments and ordinances of God, such as this was, the observance of the Passover was one, there are points at which your faithfulness is tested. God tells you to do something. For instance, if any man sin, we have an advocate with the Father, and you're told to confess that.
Yes.
Confess that sin. See that? Timeliness.
Amen.
Timeliness. So the commandments of God are hallmarks that tell you where you're at in relation to God, how long it takes you to catch on and obey, this sort of thing. I suppose that would have sufficed for most people just to do it when God said, but God, Jesus wanted more than that.
Yes.
So he stayed behind. He was at this Passover. This whetted his appetite. He said, well, at least that's so much for that. Let's head back to home. This wasn't the way he was. At 12 years old, this is not the way he was. And so he stayed behind. Because this environment that God had ordained, now God ordained his environment, this environment that God ordained whetted his appetite, and he didn't want to leave.
Yeah.
And we're going to find that he figured his parents should have known this. But Joseph and Mary should have known this is the way he was. Mm-hmm. But that's how it turned out. So there they supposed he was in the company, so they were traveling like in a caravan, we'd call it, and friends and acquaintances, they all went together. You know, David talked about going in company with people to the house of God. They went with other people. I was glad when they said to me, let us go to the house. See, the Lord, they traveled together in this, and they thought he was somewhere among the group. It was their religion that banded them together. Just interesting to observe those things, isn't it? It's their religion, not just their blood relation, their religion banded them together. And so they journeyed together while they supposed that he was with the kinfolk. And they finally sought him. They began seeking him among the kinsfolk and the kinsfolk and acquaintances. That's like those, the kinsfolk and acquaintances. They were all Jews, all went to the Passover together, all came back together, and they didn't find him among them. So they turned back to Jerusalem, seeking him. Mm-hmm. You probably thought of this, but it's good to think of it again.
Yeah.
If at some point in your life you got off the path, and you became unfaithful, there's a sense in which you got to go back there and get on it again. You can't just take over here.
Yeah,
you got to get back to where you were not sensitive and become sensitive again. Just like they had to go back where they lost Christ to find him.
Right.
They had to go back and look for him.
In Pilgrim's Progress, when he came to the Hill of Difficulty, he fell asleep and left the scroll, and then he went on without it.
Yeah.
He had to go back and get the scroll before he could keep going.
He had to go back.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
So after it came to pass, after 3 days, I guess that was a day, they were a day out, one day in, 2 days, the day hunting, 3 days. So I gather that's the way he's talking about. They were a day's journey out. That's roughly about 24 miles, I understand. 20 to 24 miles. So they walked 24 miles out, then had to walk 24 miles back, and then spend a day searching for him. They found him in the temple, in the temple courts. It wasn't in the temple proper. People weren't allowed in the temple proper, consisting of the holy place and the holiest of all. People weren't allowed in there. Only the priests were there, but they had these courts. And there's a picture of, this is a picture scale model of Herod's temple. It's in Israel. And they had a lot of yards called courts. One of these courts is where that lame man was. It was healed by Peter. Remember, he was found leaping in the temple. That's where he was at. He was in these courts. And somewhere in these courts, they found Jesus. And it was a little group of people, maybe it was a big group of people around him. And there he was in the temple, sitting in the middle of the doctors. doctors in the scripture means teachers. In the Jewish economy, the teachers were the highest elevation. And there he was in the middle of them, one of the experts in the law, the experts in scripture. See, and God raised people to place a value on someone that could communicate, understood and communicate the word of God. Now, this is not the standard of America, or even the American church. Generally, the person who's allocated to be leader is a good organizer, or this sort of thing. But in the Jewish economy, being a teacher had the precedence, and that's what Jesus was known as. Jesus was known as a teacher. Master means the same thing. Rabbi means the same thing. But you know, in the average church, Jesus is not known as a teacher. Isn't that interesting? Not known as a teacher. But that's what he is primarily, as a teacher. Notice how young Jesus was sitting in the middle of the doctors, surrounded. It's telling you something about him. At last, he's able to hold dialogue about some of these subjects that he was inquisitive about.
You described it that way. He was surrounded. That means that the people were drawn to him.
That's right.
Usually, yeah. You don't just push yourself in the middle. The people come to you in that space.
And see, you're exposed to, this is the ideal 12-year-old mindset. Are you being exposed to it? He was just like, he's an ideal man. He's an ideal 12-year-old.
Yep.
He's an ideal 12-year-old to be absorbed with the idea of learning Christ.
Yeah. Yeah.
There he was, sitting in the midst of them. Mm-hmm. And there was a group of people around listening to this whole thing going on because it was so unusual. All that heard him were astonished at his understanding and answers. Well, 12 years old, why? The picture you get is sometimes they'd make affirmations and he'd ask a question about what they said, and it was like an arresting question. And when they asked him a question, he gave an arresting answer, and it was astounding. This is the boy that Joseph and Mary raised. This is not a boy an angel raised. This is the boy Joseph and Mary raised, using all the resources they had. The angels protected him. Lest he dash his foot against a stone, so to speak. And they were astonished, amazed. Later in Christ's temple, in Christ's ministry, the temple will be the place where he taught and answered various questions again. Quite frequently, he's pictured it as teaching in a temple. So he took over that function. Now, there's no rational explanation for the obvious wisdom and understanding of this 12-year-old boy. It was God out of the picture. They perceived something in Jesus that wasn't in the average 12-year-old boy. But they saw it. Now, I can tell you that the way the church is set up in our day, there is not a venue where young experts can, like, surface. It's not set up that way. Young people are escorted off to a separate place and separate teacher, see? But here's a 12-year-old boy, and he's with the premier teachers. Not the premier youth leaders, the premier teachers. And that's where he is, listening to them, and asking questions and giving answers. So they perceive something in this boy that wasn't in normal boys. Until this time, we're reading about, instead of Jesus, he waxed strong in spirit and was filled with wisdom, and the grace of God was upon him. And what we're seeing here is what all of that produced. produced this kind of young man. At this point, everything hadn't been given into his hand. That didn't happen until he was exalted. There's a sense in which he was given what all God's children are given at this point, with the exception that it was eventually without measure given to him. I think many professing Christians grossly underestimate the level of spiritual understanding that's possible in like a 12-year-old.
Yeah.
I think children are treated too much like children. He's just a child. Well, maybe that person's not just a child.
Yeah, that's right.
Maybe that's an extraordinary child. Mm-hmm. Some of you do. Some of you sitting here have some extraordinary children.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Some people have seen it. They see it. Journey people see it. And it's a kind of it's kind of an astounding thing when you see it, because it's not normal. Oh, boy. I mean, it is something when a old Seth, a 5-year-old boy gets up to sing a song and says, I'd like to sing it first in Latin and then in English. I mean, this is not something normal. And it wasn't a little ditty, you know, a little kiddie ditty.
Yeah.
Wasn't that sort of thing. All right, now when those of Mary see this, they were amazed. They were amazed, utterly amazed. Now let's keep in mind that this wasn't the first time they'd been told something about Jesus. Gabriel told Mary that he would be called the Son of the Highest, and the Lord God shall give unto him the throne of his father David, and he shall reign from the house of Jacob. Gabriel told her the Holy Ghost is going to be upon her, and the power of this highest overshadower, that thing will be born of thee, be called the Son of God. Joseph was told he was going to save his people from their sins. Shepherds were told that he was going to be good news to all people. Simeon said that he was salvation prepared before the eyes of all the people, a light to light the Gentiles. Simeon told him he was set for the rise and fall of many. The wise men came from the east and worshipped him. So they've been exposed to a lot of reactions about Jesus. Mm-hmm. Now 10 years have passed.
Yeah.
10 years have passed. And it's kind of rubbed off on who Jesus was. It's kind of rubbed off. He grew up under their tutelage, yet they apparently lost a grip concerning the absolute distinctiveness of Jesus. So they're amazed at this. Now, as long as men and women are in the body, regardless of how much truth they've known, it can be under certain circumstances, it can elude their understanding. Just all of a sudden, just... you speak and act and live just as though those things were never known. That's why pure minds had to be stirred up.
Amen.
That's why. Now, the jeopardy of forgetfulness is not owing to any deficiency in the new creation. It's not that when you're created in Christ Jesus, you're like vulnerable. That isn't it. It's that you're in a hostile realm. And this hostile realm can defile you. So you can be raising the Son of God, concerning whom you've received some very significant information, and all of a sudden you're treating him like he's an ordinary son. That happened to Joseph and Mary.
Yes.
That's the jeopardy of living in this world. His mother, she said to him, Son, why hast thou thus dealt with us? Why did you do this to us? Cause us to worry like this? To some, this may sound like a legitimate complaint. Well, at least he could have done is tell him where he was, you know. It's never wrong to defer to God. Now, you got to settle that in your mind. It's never wrong to defer to God. And we're going to see that they should have known that's where he was. Now listen to what Mary says. Thy father and I have sought thee sorrowing. Your father and I have sought you anxiously, the New King James says. Technically, Joseph knew he wasn't the father of Jesus. And Mary knew it even better than he did. And maybe some can dismiss this, say, well, he was a legal father, so to speak. And all, we know by what Jesus answered that this was not an acceptable statement. I want to read to you something that some others have said about this that just kind of blessed me. I reached this conclusion, but it was edifying. Some others did too. Here's what a pulpit commentary says. The 12 silent, uneventful years of life at Nazareth, the poor home, the village carpentry, the natural development of the sacred child, and had gradually obscured for Mary and Joseph the memories of the infancy. They had not forgotten them, but time and circumstance had covered them with a veil. Now they were very gently reminded by the boy's own quiet words of what had happened 12 years before. Here's John Calvin. Whatever we owe to men must yield to the first table of the law, that God's authority over us may remain untouched. Thus we ought to obey kings and parents and masters, but only in subjection to God. That is, we must not, for the sake of men, lessen or take away anything from God. And indeed, a regard to the superior claims of God does not imply a violation of the duties which we owe to men. In other words, there had been enough evidence in Jesus that they should have known this what this circumstance was.
Yeah.
When he said, "Why did you seek me?" what he was saying was, "Why didn't you come here first?
Yeah. Yeah.
You should have known this is where I'd be.
Yeah. Amen.
Why didn't you know that this is where I'd be? That'd be about my father's business. Why didn't you know that? He's 12.
Yeah, that's right.
Well, no, they didn't make any attempt to answer the inquiry. Mm-hmm. Now, some of the verses, how must be about my father's business? Some say it was necessary I be in my father's house. A number of versions say that house. Is it a business? It's based on what I understand the Syriac version. I like the business. My father's business. Mm-hmm. Because in those days, the father's business was conducted in the temple. That's what went on there.
Right.
Was things pertaining to God. Mm-hmm. And things pertaining to God. That's what the priest did. So this was the place where God's business was transpired, in the temple. You should have known that's where I'd be. Now, this teaches us the distracting power of ordinary life. He led ordinary life, carpenter life, so forth. You know, it was just ordinary life, nothing wrong with it in particular. But it had a clouding effect.
Yes.
Ordinary life. Ordinary life has a clouding.
Yes.
That's why you've got to work as unto the Lord, labor as unto the Lord. Whatever you do, do all to the glory of God. That's why that's imperative. Because if you don't do that, ordinary life, which is not of itself sinful and wrong, will actually hide the things of God from you.
Yes.
And the first thing you know, you'll be treating Jesus like he's just another person. Just like they did.
Uh-huh.
That's what they did. The distracting power of ordinary life. And it says they didn't understand the saying. What's he mean? I must be about my father's business. They didn't understand that. Now, Simeon had prophesied, and Joseph and Mary marveled at what he said, remember? Luke 2:33. Jesus' response to Mary, when he responded, she said, they understood not the saying which he spake unto them. Later, those who heard Jesus had the same difficulty. They didn't understand what he said. When speaking of his death to his disciples, he taught his disciples and said unto them, the Son of Man is delivered into the hands of men and so forth. He said, but they understood not this saying. His disciples, they didn't understand. When he rode into Jerusalem, remember that? Thy king cometh riding on the colt, the foal of an ass. These things understood not his disciples at the first.
Mm-hmm.
But when Jesus was glorified, then they understood it.
Mm-hmm.
Pharisees, when he spoke of being a good shepherd, they understood not what things that were that which he was spake unto them. They didn't catch it. See, so you learn the world has an effect mm-hmm. upon the understanding of people.
Yes.
Let's just take like one of these meetings here. Mm-hmm. Let's say a person had been immersed in the activities of the world. They weren't particularly sinful, you understand, mm-hmm. but they were inordinately absorbed with them, and when they come in, they can't understand what's being said. Yeah. What do you mean? And it's not because these people are dumb or stupid mm-hmm. or slow. It's that the world has that effect. Yeah. If you don't use the world, not abusing it, see? If you don't make the world your servant, yeah. and what you do in the world, you do for God, mm-hmm. you'll end up just like these. You yeah. will not understand what Jesus is saying. Perhaps you've even experienced this. Then it didn't take the matter any further. He went down with him to Nazareth. He was subject to them. He was an obedient child. But his mother kept all these sayings in her heart. That's not the first time that's happened. Yeah, that's right. She did the same thing when Simeon spoke. She, uh-huh. when she heard the shepherd's yeah. report, that same thing, she put that in her bank of thought
yes.
to ponder it and think upon it. Jesus spoke of things that are treasured up in the heart. Now, this is like a spiritual aptitude you want to develop. Mm-hmm. Things you hear, you don't, at first, you don't get a hold of them. You don't have a firm grasp on them, but you store them away
yes.
for a future consideration. And he spoke about that. Here's what he said, Matthew 13:52. Therefore, every scribe which is instructed under the kingdom of heaven is likened to a man that is an householder, which bringeth forth out of his treasure things new and old. That's the pondering area.
Yeah.
Laid up these things in her heart. That's a treasure. See, you've got a treasury. You've got a treasury of things new and old.
Yes.
Things that you've got a hold of, you know what they mean. And things that you're not quite grasping, you like to ponder them more, but this is like a holy art.
Yeah.
Being able to store up mm-hmm. in your treasure what you hear but don't grasp. See, some people just say, well, I don't understand. They just throw it away.
Mm-hmm.
They literally throw it out of the dung heap
because
they can't understand it. So what's the use? No, you got to take it in.
Mm-hmm.
Put it in your treasure and ponder. That's what Mary did.
Yeah.
I know that later on a lot of this dawned on Mary.
When Jesus answered her in the temple there, I think a lot of these things probably came back to her mind,
mm-hmm.
probably her and Joseph both.
Yeah.
There was a lot revealed about Jesus before he was born, and then what the angels said,
that's right.
and then what the shepherds came and said,
that's right.
and what the wise men
Simeon.
Said, what Simeon said. There was a lot of things to come back to mind.
Amen.
Yeah.
That tells you something about Mary. See, that this is the person God chose to bring his son into the world. Joseph and Mary were the parents he chose, and they were premier people, but even these premier people, you learn from that Jesus can become ordinary if you yourself are caught up in the ordinary.
Uh-huh.
You will see Jesus as an ordinary person.
Yes.
And that's by design.
Mm-hmm.
God won't let you see who Jesus is if you're not preeminently interested in him. He will not.
Amen. Yeah.
You just won't see it. Well, he went back with them. He was subject to them, obeyed them. And then it says this about him again. He increased in wisdom and stature and favor with God and man. Increased in wisdom. I get the picture. Whatever Jesus learned intelligently, he was able to put into life. See, he's able to translate it into life. He increased in wisdom, increased in knowing how to do this and that, when to do this and that. And he increased in stature. Some versions say he grew taller. Well, I don't like that.
Mm-hmm.
It's the outwardly he matured just as he did spiritually. He grew up into a man. He had a man's body for a man's spirit to do man's work in the kingdom of God. Now, it's true that some Grecian philosophers like Homer used the word used here to denote age, and some versions say he grew older. That's how they say, rather than he increased in stature, they say he grew older in age, but I don't think that's what it meant. It meant that he matured outwardly. Jesus used the word that way. He said, can you add one cubit to your stature? See, so it's the physical part. He increased in stature, matured. So maybe he looked like a 12-year-old when he was in a temple, but when he strolled out on the down there by the river where John the Baptist was, he didn't look like a 12-year-old then. And he increased in favor with God. How about that? So you think that Jesus had a kind of a static level of divine favor. No, he increased in favor. See? He had to humble himself to be in that position.
Yes.
Required humility on the part of the Word. He had to divest himself of the right to do things as God does them. See? And he became a man. So he increased in favor with God. So God became more and more pleased. He was able more and more to say, well done, good and faithful servant. And this is, I gather, is how we want our children to increase in favor with God.
Amen.
And he increased in favor with man. How about that? That is essential. Word of God says considerable about this. Paul admonished people to do things that are acceptable to God and approved unto men. So our lives should not be lives that can be condemned by the world.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Paul also said, providing for honest things, not only in the sight of the Lord, but also in the sight of all men. Don't live a way so the world can condemn the way you live.
Yeah.
Just in favor with God and man. Said of the early church that they had favor with all the people. They were not there was a lot of people coming in from other parts of the world, but they didn't have to increase the police force, so to speak. They didn't do damage to the city. They didn't burn down any sticks in Jerusalem. They did things approved of men. We have renounced, Paul said, we've renounced the hidden things of dishonesty, not walking in craftiness or handling the word of God deceitfully, but by manifestation of the truth, commending ourselves to every man's conscience. Sight of God, which we can tell any person, you live in God, you can tell any person, examine my life, look at it with a magnifying glass. If you find things that are not acceptable, I'm willing to receive the assessment. For us, this is showing all good fidelity, that we may adorn the doctrine. So your life is like a set of beautiful clothes put on the doctrine. The doctrine becomes attractive when it's lived out.
Yes.
The attractiveness, of course, is to those of a good and honest and good heart. We understand that. But as you live out the truth, there is something attractive about it.
Amen.
There's something attractive by it, by a holy and a godly life. It's an appealing to people that have honest hearts and are good. But there you're introduced to the 12-year-old Jesus. You'll not be told anything else about him until he's 30. Next 12 years, nothing. But that means nothing essentially changed. After you read those words from that time, 12 to 30, he continued to increase in wisdom and stature and favor with God and man. See, he continued. All the time he was under their care, he was in subjection to his parents.
Yeah.
I think it's a it's a very necessary view of the Lord Jesus Christ. Some people have, they're not clear about Jesus being sinless and Jesus being perfect. They're a little unclear about it. I remember some time back on Facebook, a man made a posting that Jesus was like other children that had colds and was a lady awake at night with the flu, and I had to tell him, no, Jesus didn't lay awake at night with the flu. He wasn't like, but see, the people, when they read it, he was made like unto us, they take this too far. They take this too far. He was not in any way weak morally.
Amen.
And I gather he was not weak physically either. Mm-hmm. So much so that his body saw no corruption.
That's right.
He wasn't buried. Mm-hmm. Any of you have something you'd like to add? Yes.
Yeah, so it's so much for saying or giving an excuse, well, it was just my environment. Yeah. I was raised in a bad environment.
Yeah, so
well, Jesus was raised in a really bad environment.
That's right.
And yet, see, there was nothing in him that desired that environment.
Amen. Remember Nathaniel said, yeah, can anything good come out of Nazareth?
That's right. That's like the worst environment.
That's right.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. We have this account that Jesus increased in all these things. They're all virtues. So if the Son of God increased in favor with God, then how much more should we as children increase in favor with God? He's given us the resources to do so. So how shall we escape if we neglect so great salvation?
Yes.
If
Amen.
Jesus did this, then we can too.
Amen.
Amen.
There was an early heresy called adoptionist Christology. That some people actually taught, some early heretics taught, that when Jesus was baptized by John, that God adopted him as his son. And this text, I think maybe one of the reasons it's included in the Gospels, to show us that, no, Jesus consistently was the Son of God.
Yes.
Amen.
Even at 12 years old, he knew who he was.
Amen.
I have to be about my Father's business.
Yes.
So it's not like all of a sudden, at age 30, there was this like massive transformation in Jesus' person.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. That's right.
See, this is he's consistently before he was born, he said he's going to be called the Son of God.
That's right.
After he was born, he was worshipped. The wise men worshipped him.
Yes.
Even the womb, he was called that holy thing.
Yes, yeah. Amen.
At 12, he's in the temple.
Yeah.
Amazing. All the see. So this is. This is show. This is consistent. This is who he is.
Amen.
He is the Son of God. There wasn't like a point in time where like he somehow there was some kind of transformation. Now he did humble himself.
Yes.
But but other than that, this is who he was.
That's right.
It's
Amen.
Consistency.
Amen.
Amen.
Mm-hmm.
Yes,
I think there's a danger in making Jesus too much like us.
Mm-hmm.
Just a man. That there's also a danger in thinking of him as if he was just pretending to be a man.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
He acted like he was tempted, but he really wasn't tempted,
yes,
because after all he was God. There's so much in the record of the Gospels that is like it's proof that Jesus had humbled himself.
Amen.
Things like he was tired and he was hungry and he grew and he was taught.
Mm-hmm.
That's evidence that he really did take on him the form of a man.
Amen.
Really was humbled. But then you also have that he calmed the sea and he multiplied the bread and the demons were subject to him. And so that's evidence that he wasn't just a man. Jesus had to be a man, and he had to be divine.
Uh-huh.
Amen.
In order to do the work that God has given him to do.
Amen.
I didn't say a lot on this. That he in favor with God. That it's a very arresting thought to me. He grew in favor with God.
Uh-huh. Amen. Yeah.
What Brother Aaron said was very important, because if you know anything about a lot of the controversies that men have had about who Jesus is. See, there's been a lot of controversy, even in the church, about who is Jesus. And it's interesting that the early heresies tended to emphasize that he was divine, but not fully human. The Gnostics, for example, there was an old some old text that said when Jesus walked on the beach, he didn't leave any footprints. And there was a lot of weird stuff like that that was said by these ancient heretics because they had a trouble because of the Greek philosophy and everything. They had trouble with the idea that God could become a man. See, because they believed that that everything material was evil and the body was evil and that sort of thing. In our day, it's almost flipped to the other side.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
And now you have people saying, well, of course he was a man, but I just read this the other day. I just read it. There was a New Testament scholar who said, Jesus never said he was God. And that was something that was invented years later. See? And so now the heresy is on the other side.
That's right.
And people are questioning that, was he really the Son of God now? Was he really God in the flesh? That's what our age is saying.
Yes.
He is set for the rise and for the fall and rise of many.
Many.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yes, Brother Isaiah.
One of the unique things is that on the cross, Jesus was still God and man when he transferred responsibility for his mother.
Yeah.
That's right.
Yeah.
He did the stand up guy thing.
That's right.
He's a perfect man.
Amen.
Perfect God.
That's right.
Amen. I was thinking too, Jesus grew in favor with God and man, and this incident in the temple when he was 12, he told his parents, didn't you know I should where I would be? Well, I think sometimes people don't expect enough out of someone who's born again.
Amen.
I mean, yes, if they're born again and it just happened, then they're going to be a babe. But if they've been born again a while, there should be maturity.
That's right.
Should be growing in favor with God and man.
That's
and they
right.
should be able to be growing in wisdom and be expected to learn how to use this wisdom and start making use of it.
Amen.
So that they can glorify God in the things that they
do. Amen. May grow and advance in favor.
Amen.
Yes, amen.
Favor.
That's right.
Yes,
that's right.
You were talking about not knowing anything between age 2 and age 12. The Bible speaks nothing about what happened during that time. I read something years ago, just standard, about someone just being imaginative and saying, I can imagine that Jesus, probably when he was real little, probably performed some miracles with the kids he played with, and I have more to eat over here, or whatever, I can't remember. It's important to remember that the Holy Spirit reveals what we need to know.
Yes.
Yes.
It doesn't matter what really happened in between there.
Right.
God is governing all that, has done all that.
Yes, sure.
That was all within his will. You don't really have to, but some people get off on their curiosities, like where did the woman come from that, married Cain later, things like that.
Yeah, there was tradition about him turning clay pigeons into real pigeons, and then some of the apocryphal books attempt to explain miraculous things he did, but the scripture never says that, because the Spirit came on him when he was baptized.
Yeah, that's right.
That's when he was endued for this ministry he had. But the men, they're kind of inquisitive overly inquisitive about that period. Yeah.
In response to those sort of questions, part of Jesus' humility was that he waited for the Father's appointed
time to do various things.
And that included his godly submission to, by the way, everybody who truly actually was his inferior. And so if Christ could do that in the Spirit, if he could rightly humble himself and even submit to those he created.
That's right.
In the Spirit, in full submission to the Father, then that speaks to us also, that there are going to be times when we know we may have more resources than a person is willing to utilize. We know we have more capacity, better discernment, whatever, than those we may be placed under submission to in our workplaces and otherwise. But if Christ is able to if he showed the example of being humble and still being light, then we also can have that power and wait for the appointed time in which we will be glorified with him.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
Yes.
Amen. All right, we'll have a word of prayer. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for this record. We stand in thanks, great spirit of thanksgiving, that our salvation is in charge of the Lord Jesus, who passed through the kind of things we passed through with the resources that are reserved for us also. So help us to be followers of yourself and of Jesus as dear children. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.